Are you curious about how JavaScript code is executed in a browser or in the server side? In this video, we will be exploring JavaScript Engine in depth. We will learn how JavaScript Engine works under the hood to interpret and execute our code. Hi, I am Rohan Roy, and let's get to it. A JavaScript engine is responsible for interpreting and executing a code. Its process include reading the code, converting it into a machine code, and then executing that machine code. JavaScript engines are typically found within JavaScript runtime environment, which may include browsers, Node.js, or even service workers. But how does the JS engine actually work? The JavaScript engine has six primary components that work in conjunction with each other as a cohesive unit. These are parser, abstract syntax tree, interpreter, profiler, compiler, and optimized code. We will look at each of them briefly to understand how they interrelate and work together. The first component is a parser. When a parser encounters a script tag with a source, then the source code within that tag is loaded as a UTF-16 byte stream into a decoder. This decoder decodes the bytes into tokens that are sent to the parser. To optimize performance, the decoder avoids parsing unnecessary code immediately. As an example, we will create a recursive function that calculates factorial of a number. We will use this to visualize the intermediate steps in which the code is translated by the JS engine. We will quickly run it to see if it works. Perfect. We are going to use JS tokens to convert our factorial code into lexical tokens. Is there a better way to do it? Let me know in the comment section. But anyway, we will use fs to read factorial.js and then convert it into a string. Then pass it to JS tokens, after that convert it into an array, then convert it into a JSON, and then we will write it into a JSON file. When we run this, you will see a new file is created. When we open this file, we can scroll and see that our entire code is broken into tokens. So these are the tokens which the JS engine utilizes to parse our code. The second component is abstract syntax tree. Nodes are created by the parser based on the tokens it receives. With these nodes, it creates an abstract syntax tree. This is a data structure that represents the syntactic structure of the source code. A tree-like structure that captures the hierarchy and relationship between the different parts of our code. The nodes of the tree represents various elements of the code such as functions, variables, expressions, and statements. By using this tree, the JS engine can perform various operations on our code, such as code optimization, code generation, and analysis of the code complexity. Now, there is a great resource that you can use to see how your code is actually converted into an abstract syntax tree. I will put the link down in the description. We are going to use abstract syntax tree library to convert our factorial code into an abstract syntax tree. You can use this library or go to astexplorer.net, up to you. It will give you more or less the same result. We will use fs to read the factorial.js file and then convert it into a string. Then use parse method with loc and range as true, which will give us syntax tree object. Then we will convert it into a JSON and then write it into a file. When we run this, we will see a new file is created. When we open this file, we can scroll and see that our AST is created. This AST is then used by the JS engine to generate bytecode. The third component is the interpreter. The interpreter is responsible for processing the AST by creating bytecode and then executing it line by line. Once the bytecode is generated, then the AST is removed from the memory to free up space. However, one drawback of using an interpreter is that executing the same code again and again can become slow. As a result, compilers are preferred because they are more optimized and do not repeat loops, for instance. Now, to convert factorial.js code into bytecode, we are going to use print bytecode flag to run this in a Node.js terminal. We will see this in the terminal, or we can save the result in a text file. Let's save this in a file. So we will create a script that will do this for us, and we will simply run the script. We can see that a new file is created, and when we open this file, We can scroll and see the bytecode that is generated when we run a JS code. Personally, I am quite surprised at how much code is there. Anyway, this can then be used to generate executable native machine code. The fourth component is a profiler. The profiler is a tool that observes and tracks the performance of the code in order to enhance its optimization. The fifth component is a compiler. The engine's compiler compiles our code down into an executable machine code. Most modern web browsers use a just-in-time compiler that dynamically compiles our code at runtime. The JIT compiler optimizes the code based on runtime information and generates highly optimized machine code that can be executed more efficiently than the original code. Now, to convert factorial.js code into native machine code, we are going to use print code flag and run this using Node.js terminal. We can see this in the terminal or we can save the result in a text file. Let's save this in a file. So we will create a script that will do this for us and we will simply run the script. We can see that a new file is created, and when we open this file, we can scroll and see all the machine code that is generated when we run a JS code. This is the code that is actually being executed. Optimized code is the last step. The code has been transformed and optimized by various components of the JavaScript engine to execute more efficiently. This can include things like reducing the number of instructions to execute a piece of code, removing redundant operations, and minimizing the amount of memory used by the code. The optimization process typically occurs at runtime, with the profiler component collecting important information about the code's execution and using this information to generate more optimized code, which is then executed. So how does JS Engine utilizes these six components to convert our JS code into optimized executable machine code? The JavaScript engine parses the source code and then converts it into an abstract syntax tree. This AST is used by the interpreter to generate bytecode. Once the bytecode is generated, the interpreter can start executing our JavaScript code. To improve performance, the bytecode can then be passed to our optimizing compiler with profiling data, which is generated by a profiler. The optimizing compiler uses this data to make certain assumptions about our code to generate highly optimized machine code. However, if any of the assumptions made by the compiler are incorrect, then it will revert it back to the interpreter in a process called de-optimization. Different engines use different architecture, but if we look at it from a higher level, then they use more or less the same components. I want you to smash that like button if you are enjoying the video so far. After the JS code is converted into an executable code, the code execution starts using call stack and memory heap. The call stack or the execution stack is a data structure that keeps track of the currently executing function and where to return to when the function call is completed. When a function is called, a new execution context is created and added to the top of the stack that contains information about the function, such as its local variables. And when the function completes, its execution context is removed from the top of the stack and control is returned to the function or script that called it. By the way, if maximum call stack is reached, such as an infinite loop or a never-ending recursive function call, then it results in stack overflow. I talk about execution context and call stack in one of my previous video. You can check that out. I will put the link down in the description or in the info card. The engine uses memory heap to store objects, variables, and functions which are created during the execution of the code. It is used for allocating, using, and releasing memory. The data in the memory heap are stored in an unordered fashion, and variables are used to point to various locations in the heap. When a function is called and local variables are created, then they are stored in the memory heap with a reference to their location in the memory. The call stack contains references to these variables so the engine can access them whenever they are needed. By the way, memory leaks occurs whenever memory is no longer being used or required by an application, but it still takes up memory. So the call stack and memory heap work together to manage the execution of our JavaScript code. The call stack calls a function from the memory heap and after executing it, removes it from the stack. Now, one advantage for us is that it automatically frees up memory that is no longer being used through garbage collection. So, to put it all together, the JavaScript engine executes our code in several steps. It reads the source code and breaks it down into tokens, which are then used to create an abstract syntax tree that represents our code. The engine generates bytecode from the AST and executes it, managing memory allocation and deallocation as necessary. During execution, the engine may try to optimize the code by analyzing its performance and try to generate optimized machine code using profiling data. Overall, the engine converts our JavaScript code into machine code and executes it in a managed environment, responsible for managing the call stack, memory heap, and executing the code as efficiently as possible. In my upcoming video, I will talk about how JavaScript engine is part of a greater whole, the JavaScript runtime. So please subscribe if you want to stay in touch. If you are interested in core JavaScript topics, you can check this playlist out. Thank you for your time. Have a nice day. Namaskar.